Hey, good morning, everyone. Here are some upcoming announcements and events. The scripture of the week is Psalm chapter 100. Be sure to read and study it with family and friends. Special thanks to everyone who's been able to attend our drive-up services. Another big special thanks to all of those who prepared the church grounds, those who served during the service, and our tech team for providing the sound for the services and putting the messages on YouTube and Facebook. The services have been a huge blessing. Some of our members were able to interact with those passing by. Let's continue to see how God will use us. Make plans to join us for our virtual vacation Bible school, beginning Sunday, August 9th from 2 to 3 p.m. Information and materials needed to access and participate in our virtual vacation Bible school will be available on Sunday, August 2nd. Be sure to email us any questions you may have. We hope you can join us for Bible lessons, crafts, games, STEAM, and music. Hope to see you guys there! We will be holding a special back-to-school prayer and activity on Sunday, August 30th, during the drive-up portion of the morning service. The Christian Education Department will be blessing families who need to purchase school supplies. Please note that due to safety guidelines from the CDC, state government, and changes in how students will return to school this fall, we are not collecting back-to-school supplies. If you have any questions, be sure to email us or call the church office. Moving Up Sunday will also be held Sunday, August 30th. Students who will be moving to the next grade level in the Christian Education Department will be announced. Virtual Children and Youth Sunday returns August 30th. Our children and youth will be sharing various presentations on the theme, Knowing God, Knowing God's Word, based off of the scripture, Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. Additional information has been emailed to parents, so be sure to tune in. During this time, there are several ways for you to continue to worship the Lord with your giving. You can download the Givelify app and locate Turning Point Church, or you can visit tpcglobal.org/giving. If you have not been getting the TPC newsletters or have not been contacted by a member of our pastoral care team, please give the church office a call. We'd love to hear from you. And although we aren't physically meeting, we are still virtually meeting, so be sure to connect with us at tpcglobal.org.
Turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 23 to 32. When you get it, honk your horn, please. Amen. Okay, you could just follow along with me as we read. Start with verse 23. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason, many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we would not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened by the Lord, that we may not be condemned with the world." Holy Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord God, that it is sharper than any two-edged sword. Father, I thank you for this opportunity to be your mouthpiece. I request, Lord God, that your servant decrease this morning so you could increase. And by the increase of your presence among us, O God, that revelation and rhema will come to your people this morning as we re-examine, Lord God, this ordinance that you have provided, this Eucharist that you've provided for us to show our remembrance of what Jesus has done. We ask this now in Jesus' name, and the people of God say amen,
amen.
And amen. Alrighty. So, in an effort to continue with our series on temperature check of our different areas in our lives leading up to when some resemblance of normalcy come back, today's title of the message is Temperature Check Communion. And it's no happenstance or chance that it coincides with the first Sunday in which we gather to remember the Lord. Take an all church pause and gather to remember the Lord. Folks, even in these times, it's more important to understand where we are in the scheme of things when it comes to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, let me give you what a meaning of communion is. Dictionary meaning is an interaction between two or more people, especially intimate association and interaction implying sympathy and confidence, interchange of thoughts, purposes, agreement, and fellowship. See, at the end of this morning's service, we'll be observing the Lord's Supper. It's an ordinance of the Christian church that was set in order by Jesus during the Last Supper in the upper room. This was done on the night of his crucifixion, the night before his crucifixion. Some faith call it the Lord's Supper. Some call it communion. Others call it Eucharist. But no matter what we call it, the symbolism and the reason for observing it should be the same. Now here, turning point, we do not believe that the bread and juice from the fruit of the vine are converted into actual flesh and blood of Jesus Christ after it's consumed, as some teach, according to the doctrine of transubstantiation. However, we believe that the bread and juice represent that flesh and blood of our Lord that was so freely given for our salvation. So while partaking of communion, it's a wonderful way of identifying and recognizing the great price that Jesus paid for our salvation. There's communion with Christ that must occur before we can be found worthy to partake of this ordinance. You see, when Christ came, he took care of the 613 laws that were bounding people. Amen? First Corinthians, the passage we read, 27 to 30, carries a solemn warning and some clear instructions to everyone who would desire to observe the Lord's Supper. You see, the Corinthians had some issues with how they were living, and Paul had to relate that to them in such a way that they understand. And it reads as follows: Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drink unworthily eat and drink damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. Now that's a pretty stern warning, some would say, admonition, same word. But Paul, as he was going through his trek to the different peoples in the New Testament, everybody had some unique issues. The Galatians had their issues. The church in Ephesus had theirs. Corinthians had theirs as well. And it was a bunch of people who probably wasn't taking this ordinance lightly and were walking around sickly, wondering why the prayer wasn't working, and a host of other things. Some even went to sleep. Could we identify with that today? So how can we make ourselves worthy? What can we do to be counted as worthy to observe the Lord's Supper? Well, firstly, there's nothing within ourselves that we could do. Nothing we could do to make ourselves worthy for anything that God has given to us. We have no power within ourselves to cleanse sins from our hearts, saints. We have no power within ourselves to draw close to God or to begin to understand His ways. We must never forget that it's by the grace and mercy of our loving God that we have the privilege of coming to Him, and it's by His grace that we have our understanding open so that we can learn from Him. Hallelujah. See, the power of sin in the heart of man is a blinding force that makes him absolutely incapable of knowing and understanding God. Indeed, he does not know, nor does he have any desire to know. The spiritual matter, because he is dead spiritually and must be born again of the Spirit of God before he can begin to learn of spiritual things. It's not so. I guess only a few agree that we are spirit beings that have to be interacting with the Father. Amen? Secondly, the only thing we can do to be counted worthy is to surrender our hearts and live unto the Lord in repentance for our sin. It is the body and blood of Jesus that makes us worthy. But you see, saints, I'm going to dive a little bit deeper in this, because this is indeed a temperature check to see where we at. There's more to this worthiness to observe than to just observe the Lord's Supper, than being cleansed by His blood and born again by His Spirit. See, as Paul was writing to the Christians of the Corinthian church, he gave some specific instructions to all who would desire to observe the Lord's Supper. If this ordinance is to be observed, and we have to partake of it as Jesus intended us to, there's some guidelines that we must follow, lest we endanger our health, our lives, and perhaps our very soul. I think that the first thing we must realize is this: not just another ordinance or tradition. See, some folks think it's okay to come up, take the cup, crack the bread, and we're done with because we pay our dues. Folks, it's a lot more than that. It's a lot more than that. You got to remember, this ordinance was established by Jesus Himself. Nothing having to do with denominations or where you are. Jesus established this by Himself. So as such, we should be very careful to follow His exact method and purpose for communion. So as we discuss this matter of communion, let me tell you that we have to be in communion with Jesus every moment of our lives, and not just at the time of observance of the Lord's Supper. Hallelujah. If we were in proper communion with Him, we would not have to worry about whether we fulfill the requirements of this ordinance or not. Amen? See, communion with Jesus is a multifaceted thing. Let me attempt to explain this to you. Jesus' body was broken for you and I. He was beaten with a flagellum, a specially designed whip that would bruise, rip, and tear the flesh each time it struck. He was lashed, drawn across by the body of the victim. His beard was plucked from his face. He was beaten with fists, crowned with a crown of long, sharp, and painful thorns, huge nails driven into his wrists and his feet, and finally, a spear was thrust into his side. All of these were methods by which Jesus' body was broken. So when we say it was broken for you and for many, understand what we are talking about, saints. Yet, no man forced him to do so. His mind was made up, determined to give his body for you and I. It was the love of God that held him to the cross. It was the grace of God that led him to Pilate's hall. It was the mercy of God that his course was set. And because of the mercy of God, we are here today, folks. John 3:16 said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Isn't it a joy to know that we, this ecclesia, has everlasting life? Hallelujah. See, Jesus' body was broken for us. He's our example. And though we are not commanded to break our body, but to treat it as a temple of the Holy Spirit, we are still obligated to break this flesh as part of our communion with Him. See, we have to break the desires of the flesh and to learn to put our bodies in subjection to the will of God. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9:27, "But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I've preached to others, I myself should be a castaway." Hallelujah. We place our bodies under subjection by prayer, fasting, and feeding of the spiritual man, so that our desires for spiritual things overcome our desire for things of the flesh. Hallelujah. It is a constant and conscious effort on our part to make sure that the body of flesh is put under subjection. Paul gives us some pretty clear instructions on how to keep the body under subjection in his letter to the Thessalonians. You don't have to turn there, but 1 Thessalonians 5:17 to 24, but I'll just read this part. It says, "Pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good, abstain from all appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will to do it." Hallelujah. See, through a constant and consistent prayer life and living in an attitude of prayer, we are ever in communion with Christ. As we examine our heart and life to make certain that we are living in obedience to his word. Amen. It's a good time to say amen. Amen. If we're in communion with Jesus, folks, we are living a life of thankfulness. Hallelujah. Amen. We acknowledge every blessing that God has bestowed upon us. Yes, and we are so grateful for each of those blessings. Hallelujah. Yes. We may have a job, we don't necessarily like it, but thank God that he has provided a job and will provide the finances that we need.
Come on.
We may not always, like the church where we attend, or the sermons may not always be what we'd like to hear, but thank God for a church where the word of God is preached and where the spirit of the Lord is allowed to move as he will. I thank God for teachers and preachers who will falteringly expound on the word of God, even when it makes us uncomfortable. For that is when it is doing what it is intended to do. We may not always agree with our loved ones, but we thank God for them. Hallelujah. We may not always like the laws of our nation or its politics, but thank God for a free country where we can worship.
Hallelujah.
We may not always have the best of everything that is in the marketplace, but thank God that He meets our needs. Hallelujah. Saints, a heart that is in communion with Jesus Christ is going to be a thankful heart.
Come on.
See, a man or woman who is living in communion with Jesus will never desire to grieve the Holy Spirit. I say again, a man or woman who is living in communion with Jesus will never desire to grieve the Holy Spirit. We often find ourselves like Paul, who says that he does what he doesn't want to do and doesn't do what he wants to do when it comes to living for the Lord. But we do not take pleasure in living that way. And our greatest desire is that we can and will be a useful vessel in God's house and in God's kingdom. How many of us could identify with that? So how often do we grieve the Holy Spirit, and how often does the Spirit of the Lord not move in the midst of the church because we simply don't care if He does or not? Thank God at Turning Point Church, we are free and we let the Spirit roam free. Thank God for Turning Point Church that we are Spirit-filled, Bible-believing praisers and worshipers of the living God. See, there's no communion with God without reverencing His holy word that has been foreordained for you to hear. Reverencing His holy word. How many of us spend time in the word every day to let it just permeate to our soul? You know, we sang a song that said, we want more of you, God. We want more of you, God. You get more of God when you just bury yourself in His word. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Get some water, please. One of the recent trends in the Christian circle has been the WWJD movement, or what would Jesus do? Anybody hear that? You know, it's on bracelets. Some people have sermons on them. You see the bumper sticker or something with the letters WWJD on them. So while it's a good thing to ask, what would Jesus do? The better question is, would Jesus do what I'm doing? Would Jesus go to the movie that I went to last night? Would Jesus read the same books that I read? Would Jesus be listening to the same music I listen to? Would He laugh at the same jokes that I laugh about?
Come on.
Would He approve of the friends I hang around with or the places I go? If we are to be in true communion with Christ, we must abstain from every appearance of evil. I didn't say that. The Word of God says that.
It's open.
See, being in communion with Jesus is more important than observing the communion ordinance. In fact, you're not living in complete communion with Him. If you're not getting on your knees and being in repentance for those things we all may slip up on every now and then. See, here's the thing, and I would like to advise this. You hear me say several times, even during the offering time and in communion time, if you have anything against a brother or sister, or anything you need to repent on, bring it before the Lord and obtain His grace and His mercy. Folks, it's not that you should. Amen. But before you get before the communion table to partake of the Lord's Supper, you need to go to the Lord with all that and get it out the system. I know some people say it's not easy to do, but just do it. It's Nike time, like Pastor used to say. Just do it. The other alternative of that is not to partake in communion at all. And if you choose to do that, then the issue runs a lot deeper. The passage we read today in 28:33 says, "Let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eat and drink it unworthily, eat and drink damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." Not discerning the body of the work our Lord Jesus, the Christ, did. "For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep." Folks, let me deal with that for a minute. There's so many times that the people will come up over and over and over again for prayer. Come up over and over again for deliverance. Over and over again for the same thing that you have the power to do on your knees if you get before God and truly repent. That's what that passage of scripture is talking about. "For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love the word of God. To partake of the Lord's Supper with sin in your heart and an unrepentant and an unregenerate soul is to say that the death of Jesus upon the cross and the shedding of His blood was meaningless. Woo. As I expected. It's like saying that we don't count the sacrifice that He made for us worth even remembering in the correct manner. Amen? Oh. Oh, them horns should have been blaring about two passages ago. God would not hold you guiltless for that kind of thinking. In fact, Paul even says that God has chosen to remove some Christians from this life because they were so irreverent and uncaring concerning the observance of the Eucharist or communion ordinance. See, God treats this ordinance with a special respect since it commemorates the sacrifice and death of His only Son. How can we treat it with any less respect? As I close this message, I want us each to stop for a moment and take stock of our own heart. Ponder for a minute. Take stock of where you at. Examine yourselves. Allow the Holy Spirit to reveal anything in you that is displeasing to God, and then repent of that thing and allow the blood of Jesus to wash it away right now. Right now. If we gonna be true before God, it gotta be at all times, folks. There's no time like the present to make sure you're right with Him before we go into our communion celebration. Let us pray. Father, before we come together to partake of the Lord's Supper, of communion, of Eucharist, Lord, I pray for each and every one of my brothers and sisters today, Lord, that anything that is displeasing to You, Holy Spirit, You our Paraclete, take charge and reveal it to us right now. Help us to be bold, to be able to proclaim, Lord, we need You. Holy Spirit, we need You. We need You now. We need You every hour. We need You now. Yes. To touch us like You never touched us before. Oh, in these times we are living, there is no surety, but Jesus is sure. He has blessed assurance. Ah, Father, just take us right now and clean us from the inside out. Every cupboard, every area of our lives. Lord, we ask for cross-examination right now. We ask, Lord God, that as you look in, Lord God, that we look in right with you. Pull out those cobwebs, oh God. Lord, we ask for us to be whiter and whiter than snow. Cleanse us right now, Holy Spirit. Cleanse us, Heavenly Father. We give you glory, honor, and praise today because we want to celebrate this the right way with the respect that is due. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We thank you, Father. There's not enough time, not enough instances on this earth to thank you for what you have done, Hero of the Ages, Lord Jesus. Because you have come, we have life, and we have it more abundantly. But Lord, we must remember that we got to walk circumspectly before you. We got to walk in the newness of life every day we get up. We got to walk knowing that Jesus is our Lord. We got to walk knowing that the Holy Spirit is here. And we look to him for direction in everything we do. We give you praise this morning, oh God.
Yes,
we give you glory this morning, oh God.
Yes,
we give you honor. In Jesus' name, the people of God say amen.
Amen.
And amen.